even for those who reach the goal, those who win. The NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series is a hard road. Difficulty and disappointment come more often than success, and win or lose, the work is grueling. No road on the circuit is more difficult than this one, the historic 12-turn course at Watkins Glen, New York, where pitfalls and pain lurk around every high-speed bend. At the end of this road, the only racing destination that really matters.
Here at Watkins Glen, Ron Fellows is going to pick right up where he left off last year. He won this race from the pole. Guess where he is today? On the pole again. But he missed the driver's meeting by 3 minutes. That means he's going to have to start all the way from the back. The man that inherits that front row spot will be right here in the number 44. That is Boris Said. But Boris has got something else on his mind because he had a run-in with Ron Barfield. Actually, I should say Barfield had a run-in with Boris. Barfield's going to start just two rows behind him. And Boris is a very unhappy camper with Ron Barfield.
We're just out there buying our time, giving the leaders a lot of room. And, you know, Ron Barfield, time and time again, you know, just gave me a cheap shot, totaled my truck in the wall, and wasn't called for. I was giving everybody room. And, I mean, if he thinks what I did to Rich Bickle was hard, he's in trouble, because what goes around comes around. And I don't take that from anybody.
Barfield was sent to the rear. He ended up finishing 12th in that race. And you heard Boris mention Sears Point. What happened there? Well, Rich Bickle had gotten into Boris a little earlier in the race. So when he came around, Boris tagged him hard. Now, there's also one other combination that could have a little contretemps right there. Greg Biffle, he got into Kevin Harvick. By the time this race goes green, those two are going to be lined up side by side. We're getting ready to go racing here at the Parts America 150.
Watkins Glen Raceway in New York kicks off its 50th anniversary celebration with the Parts America 150. The NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series comes to town, and apparently everybody is feeling a little bit cantankerous after a couple of weeks on the short track. Hello, everyone. I'm Dave Despain. We've had five different winners in six series, but everybody's in a bad mood. I'm thinking about picking a fight with this guy, Benny Parsons.
But Dave, we're coming off short tracks. We're coming off those half-mile racetracks where beating and banging really is a way of life. That's nothing unusual. But we do have a lot of guys that I'm going to get that guy the next time I get a chance.
They've got a guy sitting at the front of this field that everybody wants to get even with because he won it last year from the pole in a one-shot deal. Well, Ron Fellows, he's on the pole again, but there's a lot more to that story. We'll get to that in a moment. Right now, let's talk about the rivalry at the top of the championship fight. It's Jack Sprague, the reigning champ, against Ron Hornaday, the past champ. But behind them, Betty, and they're in a good fight, we've got some surprises.
Some real surprises. Stacy Compton's in third spot after his victory. Tony Raines, the winner last week, is in sixth spot. And how about Brian Refter in seventh and Randy Toldma in ninth spot?
Great battles for the points. A great battle coming up on the racetrack. We're going to have it all for you here on ESPN. Stand by. We'll take a commercial break and come back to tell you who starts where for the Parts America 150. Warm-up laps here at Watkins Glen. We'll take a look at Ron Fellows dropping back to the tail end of the field. He got it right on Friday, won the pole in qualifying. Got it wrong on Saturday morning when he was 3 minutes late for the driver's meeting. Officially, he will be credited with the pole. And outside row one is going to be Joe Ruttman, the California road racing veteran. And then we go back to row two. We've already heard the story of Boris Said. He will start alongside Ron Hornaday, who's had kind of a roller coaster ride in two previous victories here, or visits here to Watkins Glen. The first one was a victory and an impressive win indeed for the man who was at that time dominating road racing in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. And this bunch said, we'll come back next year and dump some more water on Hornaday, but he dumped a little water on their plans when he put the truck upside down and hard into the wall last year in practice, though he did come back to finish in fifth spot.
On the inside of row three, the defending Craftsman Truck Series champion, Jack Sprague, and on the outside, Greg Biffle, who is leading the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series point standings. There we see he has a 3-point lead over Andy Houston and Wayne Anderson. Scott Walters is 10 points back.
From the rookie rankings, we go on to pick up another couple of youngsters. Ron Barfield will start the ortho truck on the inside with Rob Rizzo, the New Yorker and former Trans Am racer alongside.
On the inside of row five is Kevin Harvick and Randy Tolsma. On the outside of row five, in row six, is Jay Sauter, Richard Childress truck, and Mike Wallace, the pure litter truck, on the outside.
Row seven has Mike Bliss, who's been struggling a good bit this season, alongside Tony Raines, who has not struggled at all during the last week. What a wonderful return engagement it was at Lake Odessa, Missouri. He won it last year in the Pennzoil Dodge. He won it last week in the Pennzoil Ford and becomes the first driver to win in two different brands of trucks. We've got Dorsey Schrader jumping into a good truck here, the former Dave Resendiz ride to go inside row eight. He's a good road racer, and he's got the former Cintas Rookie of the Year, Brian Reffner, alongside.
Inside of row nine is Randy McDonald. This is the leading Dodge qualifier today, and Rick Crawford, the winner down at Homestead, on the outside. In row 10, Terry Cook on the inside, and Rob Morgan on the outside.
Row 11 will have Barry Bodine, Jeff's son, starting alongside the Colorado veteran Rick Corelli. And then Mark Simo flanking Stacy Compton, who is coming off his first NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series victory. It's a long way from Virginia to Portland, Oregon, but the skills he learned on the bull rings on the East Coast paid off as he went to the West Coast, and Compton, the super sophomore, pulled off his first victory. We'll take you on back through the rest of the starting lineup here. There's Stacy celebrating in Portland and hoping to repeat on the road course. Take you on back through the rest of the starting lineup, Benny, as the field come down here getting set for a start. I would have to think that one of the keys for these guys is just patience and learning to adapt to the road course action.
Somehow learning patience at this racetrack is so important as they come off turn 11. That green flag is out.
Morris Sebb will take the lead as they go to turn one. It's a right-hander at the end of that long front straightaway.
Bound in the 57 truck.
Clean and green up the hill. Sedd showing the way. There's Hornaday tucked in the third spot. And all of those side-by-side controversies and fights seem to have kept things under control here through the first half of the first lap.
This is the interloop here at Watkins Glen as we ride along with Boris Sedd, the Federated Auto Parts Ford truck. Accelerates off turn nine. See Boris as he comes down the short chute. Won't be considered a backstretch here. We see the 35 car truck of Barfield trying to get the gap on Greg Biffle. And the left-hander, that's turn 10. Back to 11, and these trucks have completed one lap.
And Jack Sprague is coming to pit road. Marty, what's up with that?
This is pre-planned strategy. Dennis Conner came up to me right before the start of the race. He says, we're going to come in on the very first lap. We've really got enough gas that we can make it. So we're going to make our stop early and then go the rest of the distance. And it'll take us less time just to top it off. He's all the way at the end of pit out. He's just pulling the stop. He'll be able to get this gas and get back on the throttle. And he should be out of here literally in about a second and a half. And he's gone.
The rule is this, they must stop in each segment. They don't even have to take on the fuel, but they must stop. And we'll elaborate on why that strategy has worked out that way as we take a look at your race analysis. It's 152 miles, basically. Fellows, the track record holder. But the key to it, Benny, is that break and the pit stop thing.
Well, there is a mid-race break. The trucks will stop and change tires, change the chassis. But NASCAR says you must make at least one pit stop in the first and second segments. The reason they stop early is because now if the caution flag comes out, the leaders and the trucks in front go in the pits and all those trucks will stop, will pass them and be in front, get in that track position.
And the reason that they're making everybody stop is that some trucks can go half the race without fuel and some cannot. So it's a great equalizer or leveler of the playing field. Now, Marty, I don't think Sprague was the only truck to stop, was he?
No, Jay Sauter also came in, as well as Jimmy Hensley and Dorsey Schrader. So the strategies are already beginning to unfold. It's going to be interesting watching these guys pick their way back up through the field.
A move for position as Mike Bliss grabs second spot away from Kevin Harvick. Harvick comes back up the inside as you watch from onboard Mike Bliss's truck.
this. It's clear.
Andy Houston has come on pit road to make a stop for fuel.
This time for gas, this time.
There's Houston going out, having completed his refueling, and that's Terry Cook, who was also on pit road. Again, these early stops under green to accommodate the NASCAR requirement actually implemented this morning that everyone must make a mandatory stop. Boris Said leads the race. He last led at Sears Point in October of 1997. He is an excellent, excellent road racer with a lot of experience on this race track.
And we heard Mike Bliss, Barry Dostakowski, say pit this lap. So we'll see Bliss coming in, maybe this pit stop. There you see him. Harvick and Mike Wallace go by.
Give it up early, make it up late. Seems to be the strategy for several of the
companies. 4,000
RPMs in first gear, which is pit road speed. And right now, so he's pitting way at the entrance to pit road. If he speeds down pit road, he must come back in for a stop and go penalty. So it's critical that he keep pit road speed as he exits pit road.
We talked about patience at the green flag. This has got to be the thing that requires more patience than anything else.
35 miles per hour, and you're accustomed to run 125 down through here. There's Mark Seymour, a truck that looks exactly like our pole sitter.
Seymour is, of course, the owner of this team, but loves to drive and periodically will jump in, particularly for the road course races. There is his teammate leading the field with Hornaday in hot pursuit from the second spot. Boris Said, who did not sit in a race car until he was 25 years old, went to the Detroit Grand Prix and said, man, this is cool. I love this. Went out and bought a Mustang, went to driving school and says, used to be I couldn't say race driver. Now I am one.
He has about a second and a half lead on Ron Hornaday as he goes down to turn one. Makes that right under. Greg Biffle was in third spot. He's 2.5 seconds back.
There's Tony Raines making the early stop. Winner last week on the short track at Lake Odessa, Missouri. The roaring team truck with the Penske working on it. And he left out as others flock in behind him. Right ahead of him is Ron Fellows, your pole sitter, who had to go to the back because he was 3 minutes late for the driver's meeting. And you're thinking, what's up with that? 3 minutes. Well, last week, was it Lonnie Rush, I guess, was 30 seconds late for the meeting in Lake Odessa. And they said, guys, we treat everyone the same. The penalty is we start from the back. So Fellows is out now as others stream in alongside. None of the top three have yet stopped to make this early fuel stop. Now Fellows will be ready to jump back out there and start picking people off and see if he can bring that winning truck from a year ago back to the front in 1998 at Watkins Glen.
Down here in pit lane, Ron Hornaday, our race leader. You're saying, wait a minute, what happened to Boris Said? Well, he pitted while we were in commercial break. Here comes Hornaday. You can hear him on the radio, giving him the restraint.
Now the one, now the two, go.
That's Fred Graves, the crew chief, telling him 1,001. That's the timing system. They know they've got a full load. He's back out.
Doesn't take a lot of fuel to get you to the end of this. Now, there is
will be
second place truck, I believe, of Biffle. And once this thing all cycles around, he and number 50 also pitted during the commercial that saw Boris Said go to the pits.
There we see Brian Repter. This is now the, in fact, the leader of the race. He has not stopped. This is the inner loop. We'll go now through turn nine, a long sweeping right-hander. Accelerate down the short stretch. Marty Reed, how about Brian Repter? What's his plan?
Well, what's really interesting about Brian, guys, is that right before the race started, they had a master cylinder that was sticking. They had to change it. They just made it to the tech line in time. We don't know exactly how long they're going to stay out, but I'm sure they're loving it up front right now.
Repter was laughing yesterday. He said, this is the first time I've had a real road racing truck with real road racing geometry. He said, I flopped around here something terrible last year. Thought I had the racetrack figured out. We came here with this new road racing truck, and it had so much more corner speed that it threw all my shifting points off. We had to come back, tear the transmission apart, where I could even get the thing where I could drive it. And then when they were going to go out for the second session and check all that, they blew it up. So he's had a pretty tough week leading up to this moment when he leads the race, chased by Rick Crawford, currently second on the racetrack in the number 14. He of the recent victory at Homestead Raceway down in Florida, giving him his first career victory in this competition.
Dominic Dobson, the green and red and white Dodge truck, is in third spot.
He started off the 28th starting spot, so we've got guys at the back of the field who have elected to pit later than those who started up front and enjoy this opportunity to lead in NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series competition.
What happens right now? Jack Sprague, the first truck that pitted, is now in fifth spot. If the caution flag comes out and the pace car picks up and Brian Reppner pits, then he will go back to about 35th. That's where he would restart the race. That's why all these trucks decided to stop early. There we see Sprague. He's made his pit stop. It's Hornaday pressure. Hornaday diving to the inside. Whoa, Sprague. But that's why they decided to pit early, because to get out and hope that caution flag comes out, which will put them back up at the tail end of the, right behind the pace car.
That's the tail end of Lance Norrick that Sprague is looking at, but only briefly, as he takes the 800 Miro 2 truck up into fourth position. And there you see the view out the front of the hockey hood. Marty?
Well, you got Rick Crawford, who just came in, got his gas and go, and Chris Few was running as fast as the truck was.
Crawford, the circle bar truck, having a great year. They've reorganized that team, and just outside the top 10 in points, ranked 11th with the Homestead victory. That's going to drop him well back down into the field, though, as he makes that pit stop, and this whole thing eventually cycles around. Morissette did not have a great stop, and as a result, he is a little more than a second behind the guys he was battling for the lead. He's actually in the sixth spot in the running order, with two trucks still to stop for fuel. Three trucks still to stop for fuel. Here they come. There's Sam. He's caught Hornaday and company now. It's great. Get a little bit of wiggle there. The red and blue truck behind is Greg Biffle. As we see, he comes in the pits. Later on pit road, so we have all but completed the cycle here as Reppner comes in the Felon Racing entry, the Carlin Burner sponsored truck, to get his bit of fuel. Morris is using every bit of this racetrack as he tries to stay ahead of Greg Biffle. He had to pass Biffle. Biffle beat him out of the pit.
And he gets by Jack Sprague. And Hornaday has been able to get by Sprague. Sprague is now back to about the fifth spot, right in the front of Greg Biffle.
Keep a close eye on this and see if something has gone amiss with Sprague's truck. Of course, in road racing, if you blow one corner, that is Hornaday. They can drive down the inside and say, get out of my way, Dominic. I got to get away from these guys.
He kind of leaped across there. And we see Dobson gets losing position to Morissette. Jack Sprague is now trying to get by. Biffle is right behind Sprague.
Point I was going to make is if you get one corner wrong in a complex of turns, it can throw you off the next two or three. So it's easy to lose three spots, and it looked like the truck's going south. I think Sprague just made one mistake and paid a big price for it.
And we see Joe Ruttman, the teammate of Greg Biffle, on his back bumper.
Pretty good action early on here at Watkins Glen. And now that this thing has begun to sort itself out, let's reset the field for you. The Napa Field Summary, led by the Napa truck of Hornaday, was set in second spot. And on back to the field we go. Bush Miller.
Sprague is having some problems. He is having some problems as Greg Biffle gets by. He went in that right-hander down in turn one that the truck just pushed up. Let Biffle get position. The same thing that happened to him the last lap.
Difficulties for the championship series point leader, Jack Sprague, who has won at Monroe, finds himself backing up through the field. From the lead, he has slipped to fourth, and we'll keep an eye on this. The next guy to threaten is Joe Ruttman. Of course, Sprague and Ruttman have a bit of a history. The inside 99 coming up to take a look, and he's going to go right underneath him. There's something wrong with that truck. Marty?
Yeah, the word down here from Jack Sprague's camp is that he is way, way too tight. He's having a tough time getting through the right-hand corners.
Of which there are, what, nine on the racetrack?
Yeah, well, there's 11 corners altogether, and I think nine on the right-hander. So, yeah, you're going to have trouble in the left-hander. There's not nearly as many of them.
Several guys who run oval tracks all the time are quick to tell you that this is a great racetrack, except they run it backwards. It is a right-hand racetrack all the way around. Bad news for the
way tight.
Back with more.
I can see you there.
timeout has two purposes: to tell you who sponsors the race and also to tell you why we are under yellow in the Parts America 150. Dominic Dobson's truck has stopped on course at a place where you don't want to have trucks.
Now that's going in turn 10, a very high speed corner.
We can get a word, I think, from Marty about what the problem may be on that truck.
Yeah, guys, they're not quite sure. They've got a differential out, and then if we go a little bit to the left, you'll see the crew also working on a transmission. So they're not sure. It's one of those two problems, but obviously it's going to take a while to get him back in here so that they can fix it.
He actually led lap 9, first time that Dominic has led in this series, coming out of the open-wheel road racing Indy-type cars to the much heavier and some would say more difficult to drive trucks, or at least different to drive. And he struggled making that transition.
Yeah, now, okay, now we see the pace car is out and it's picked up the leader, Ron Hornaday. All these trucks have made pit stops. Now, we have some trucks out there that have not stopped. And what happens now when they stop? I don't think the 35 truck of, well, maybe hit Barfield left. We'll see who comes in. And when they do, they're going to the very rear of the field.
And again, making the point that you made earlier, demonstrating the point that it's better, even though the conventional wisdom is you never want to stop under green flag. All you're losing is time when you stop under green, but when you stop under yellow in this circumstance, you're going to lose positions. Let's run you back through the field with our onboard cameras in the order they're running on the racetrack. There's Boris Said, who currently second, up one from where he started, although in the end he actually started on the pole because of the problem. Here is Mike Bliss.
He's in ninth spot.
Going forward. That's good to see. Crashed the truck here on Thursday. So
yeah, wiped the truck out. This is the backup. This is the Ice House truck of Dorsey Schrader, Tom Bloy's truck.
I would look for a good day from these guys. So far they haven't made much noise, but Schrader knows how to drive this racetrack. He's running about where he started. Tony Raines, well, here we are at the road race. Let's go back to Lake Odessa.
Yes.
He's doing okay. He's holding his own right where he started, back there with Dorse. Rick Corelli, 20th, 22nd, again, holding his own. A guy who would quickly tell you that this business of turning right is a rather alien concept. NHL truck.
Lance Norrick, currently in 25th spot, started 26th, so he's been able to maintain.
Again, most of these guys, he actually worked his way. Did he actually lead the race? I think he led a lap maybe before he made his pit stop. Keselowski's had a terrible time here. Had to take a provisional in the Dodge, and I asked him yesterday what's happening. He says, man, we're just getting beat up. And he didn't have much good to say about much of anything. So Reffner, the last of the bunch to pit, is on the back of the field.
And Wayne Anderson was running in ninth spot. Running pretty good, right? He had to take a provisional. He was in ninth spot. But bad news for Wayne Anderson. When he comes out of the pits, he will be running in about 32nd spot.
He'll be right back about where he started, as
exactly.
A matter of fact.
You see him making a chassis adjustment on the back of in the bed of the truck.
Dominic had not stopped when he stopped on the racetrack, Dominic Dobson. And now this is the last truck in the field to make a pit stop. So with Anderson stopped. And note that they are taking their time. They're doing the tweaks. They're adjusting on the truck and trying to get it a little faster. That is the last truck that needed to stop.
Also, some bad news for the Brian Reffner fans. Remember, he led the race, made his pit stop. He got a speeding ticket. He got caught speeding on pit road and had to go back, had to make another stop. He's back in 30th spot, as we see Brian Reffner.
I'm not sure. They may have been having more than just routine adjustments on that Anderson truck. They're spending a lot of time on that.
I think they're adjusting the air pressure on the trucks. They're putting air pressure, air in, and taking air out, which takes quite a bit of time. But, again, he has plenty of time because he's just going to pull up the back.
Going to be in the back anyway. Here comes Dominic Dobson onto pit road. Marty's down there.
Yeah, and the guys are going to go to work taking a look first at the differential. That would be the easier of the two pieces to change, but we're not quite sure, neither are they yet. They're gonna have to diagnose. I was sort of hoping that Dominic would climb out for a few minutes. He may, because it's gonna get hot in that cockpit. If he does, we may get a chance to talk to him. So we're still under yellow here at Watkins Glen at the Parts America 150. Stay with us, a lot more racing action still to come.
It's the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series come here to kick off that celebration. Look who's here. 17th starting spot for Fellows, whose best finish was here a year ago when he won the race. But the big story, Benny, is all the people he's managed to pass through this business.
Tell you what, he's done quite well because he had to start at the very tail end of the field and has as you said, worked his way back up to 17. Green flag is out.
We will be keeping an eye on Ron Fellows' progress through the field as we watch Ron Hornaday get a whale of a jump on these guys going to turn one.
And Jack Sprague is coming down pit road. The defending champion is on pit road.
Flat. My tape's wrong and everything. It's flat. It's going flat right now.
It's flat.
Come on.
Left front tire's flat.
Easy now.
Dennis Connor trying to keep everybody cool. You may have heard as we went to the commercial break a break ago, the voice say, we're working on a plan. Well, that was Dennis Connor, and the plan they were working on was try to figure out how to fix the push. Now, apparently, Dennis came up with a flat tire so they could come in and change it. Remember, they can't change tires unless one goes flat. Marty?
Well, we're looking at the tire to see what happened. I can't tell whether it was cut or whether it let go, but you just heard Dennis Connor say, it's okay, we'll make it up.
Well, that's right. It really hasn't lost anything. All he does right now is go to the end of the field, and as soon as the caution flag comes out, he'll be right back up on the field.
And Sprague knows how to get around this race course. His best road racing finish is second out at Heartland Park, so he can do the road racing thing. One of the problems we were concerned about for him is the fact that he has the flu, but that has proven to be truck and now a flat tire. Spray goes to the back. He's lucky it happened early.
There's cheerleader Ron Hornaday, boys saying Greg Miller, Joe Rutman. Randy Tolsma's worked his way up the fifth spot. And here we go. Fellows on the inside of Jimmy Hensley gets another spot.
This is going to be fun to watch. I think Fellows is going to go to the front. This is the winner a week ago, Lake Odessa, sitting in now
14th spot
with Hornaday working on him, so he's going after Tony Raines next. Napa Field summary taking you back through the field as they cross the line at the end of the last lap, which was lap 15. Watch the break of that in the corner.
Dorsey Schrader in the 55 truck.
Dorsey and Fellows, there's a matchup.
We've seen before, haven't we?
Raines is in the middle of a pretty good road racer sandwich right there. Schrader in front of him, and Fellows coming up from the rear. Kept Fellows at bay. Let's see. Oh, I like this shot. The feet of Dorsey Schrader. But what strikes me about this shot is also the steering wheel. See how they work together.
He's using the clutch. How about that? Very few of these truck drivers and Winston Cup drivers anymore use a clutch. That's turn one that he's turning through.
And you want to do that with a good bit of delicate feel, both on braking into the corner and also your steering to hit that apex without hitting the gravel track.
He's going through the S's now on the backstretch, climbing up to a speed that we see in fourth gear. He's probably up to 150, 60 miles per hour when he starts slamming on the brakes, which ought to be about right now. Stop this, baby.
And Tony Raines right with him. Good job, Tony. Through the quick flip, left, right, and back out onto the race course, the chicane that's known here as the inner loop. No change in this in these positions. This is 13th, 14th, and 15th. As we now jump back up front to see that Hornaday is maintaining about a 5-6 truck length lead over Morissette. Last time across start finish, it was 8-tenths of a second. Tony's learning this road racing stuff.
Yes, he is. This is turn 11, the right-hander, just before the start finish line.
Thinking back, I guess Raines would have probably had the opportunity to road race a couple of times a year with the ASA division. They used to run at Brainerd and I think Heartland Park had a couple of road races a year for those guys. And he comes from that division as a former Rookie of the Year, former champion. Let's get more on the tire story as we go to Marty.
Yeah, we checked over the tire at Jack Sprague and watched the Goodyear guys go to work, and he definitely ran over something on the track. There was some debris out there, so he cut the tire down. We don't have a tire problem at all down here.
That could be a mixed blessing for Sprague because of the difficulty they were handling with having with the handling of the truck to have the opportunity to change that tire. Oh, this is bad news. Fellows has slowed down. And it looks like the pole-sitting truck is in trouble. He's already made his pit stop. This has got to be mechanical.
Yeah, Yeah, this what this looks like is a transmission problem, really. Too bad. Billy Heston, the guys I know are going to be awfully disappointed when he said blue truck coming down Penn Road running about 20 miles per hour. If he gets
that blue truck is not disappointed to see that at all. One of Ron Hornaday's primary competitors here for the opportunity to win today has gone by the wayside. Hornaday moving quickly from fourth to first, then the shuffle of pit stops, and then working his way back to the lead, a lead which he has built substantially, as you can see. It's now over a second over Boris Said in second spot. More on Ron Fellows. Marty?
Well, we may have found the Achilles heel today, guys. We may have our second transmission problem. That's what the report is from Ron Fellows, and that's what Dominic Dobson's problem was. So he's making his way to pit lane. We'll keep you posted.
Don't do a lot of shifting in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series, except when you come here and to Heartland Park and to Sears Point. Generally, it's a stick it and gear and go kind of series, but gearboxes always a potential Achilles heel on the road race courses. They're going under the hood.
Yeah, they will raise the hood. So, Marty Reid, they're not looking at plays like it's a transmission.
Yeah, I was noticing that too, Benny, but that was the initial report. I can't quite get my head tall enough over the wall to peer down in there to see what they're going after, but the motor is definitely off. It's moving very quickly around here.
Fellows came out of nowhere to win this a year ago. Trans Am star from Canada who wanted to make the transition to the trucks. Worked very hard to make that truck deal work a year ago. Had his moment in the spotlight. Came back, won the pole this year. Look out there. But now it looks like it's all come for naught. We'll take a commercial break and come back as Ron Hornaday pulls away from Boris Said. We're back at Watkins Glen. Speed World celebrating a lot of anniversaries here. The 50th here, the 95th up at Milwaukee where the CART FedEx Championship Series is running this weekend. We'll show you the pole qualifying at 6 o'clock Eastern time tonight and the race tomorrow at 1:30 Eastern time. It's the Miller Lite 200 of all the championship auto racing teams. FedEx Championship stars and cars. It's a good shot of the right front wheel of Mike Bliss's track.
Not the second spot as Biffle took a look on the inside of Boris Said, could not quite make it work.
This is happening about a second and a half behind the leader, Ron Hornaday. And that interview interval has been fluctuating a little bit. Now Hornaday has again pulled away, and Biffle apparently has the idea that Said is holding up this freight train that also includes Joe Ruttman, Randy Tolsma, and Mike Bliss. There you see it from trackside.
That's certainly the impression I got with the move that Biffle was making is, look, boys, you're holding up. I need to go up there and catch that leader.
Next step is start honking the chrome horn at you, Boris. And I know you get mad when people do that, but you got to get out of the way, buddy. Biffle's impressing me, and Tolsma, too.
Greg Biffle, Randy Tolsma, neither one of these guys you would think are road racers, as we see Biffle closing right on the back bumper of Boris Said.
Boris has done a bunch of road racing. Biffle has done a whole lot less, and the guy two trucks behind him, Randy Tolsma, his road racing experience is pretty much limited to the outskirts of Meridian, Ohio, when he was working, or Meridian, Idaho, I should say, when he was working for the local florist and had to deliver flowers from the funeral home to the gravesite before the hearse got there.
And we see Greg Biffle once again trying to get the position, and he's there.
Oh, big hit. And Said and Biffle banging on each other. I can't believe they both didn't crash. Look at the side of Said's truck. Wow. That was a huge hit.
That was big. And Biffle's truck looked like a little turnover.
I thought he was going to go upside down. I couldn't believe the next thing wasn't that they hit the tire wall. Instead, they both keep on racing. Here comes Ruttman. He'll take advantage of Boris. Ooh, if Sid was last with that, man, last week, what would it be like now? Look at the side of that truck. Oh, man. He has slipped back and forth. Both Biffle and Ruttman go by in search of the leader. We definitely got to have another look at this.
That's Biffle, the red and black truck on the inside. Oh, my goodness gracious.
he hit that curb, and he almost did turn over.
It was the curb that got him up in the air like that. There's the big dent in the side of Sed's truck, but Boris doesn't quit hitting him.
Watch this one, and listen.
Man, that's a hard hit. There's another one.
There's another one.
Wow.
Just to make sure that we know we're actually seriously competing for the position. Man. I don't know, as bad as Boris is beat up, that has to affect the hand.
But he was drifting back before this happened. Before they made contact, he was falling back. As we saw Biffle go up and obviously Bobby Biffle taking that chance to go in that corner, he felt like his horse was really holding him up.
Tough place to pass, and particularly if there's the best look we've seen at how much damage that impact did. That was a very, very hard hit. Next to catch Boris should be Jay Sauter in the Black 3, who's fifth on the racetrack, and will come up. Now, that has broken up a pretty good battle there for second, third, and fourth, but now Biffle will start eating away at that interval to the leader, Hornaday. Let's get down to Marty with last year's winner.
Yeah, this day started off real well for Ron Fellows till about 10:03 this morning, and then the drivers' meeting, and now this. What put you out?
It doesn't appear it was going to be our day. You know, the miscommunication in the location of the drivers' meeting for us, my fault. You know, we lost, broke a fuel pump or something. It's not been a good day for ADR manufacturing. And, looks like it's going to be up to Ron Hornaday and Jack Sprague to carry the Chevy boat tie today. Unfortunately, we can't.
Fellows is going to be heading back to the garage, guys.
And something has happened to Randy Tolsville. We saw him in fifth spot doing a great job, and the IWX transport truck, he's back in 30th spot, about 45 seconds behind the leader. I'm guessing he might have gotten off the course someplace, and
he might have ran off the road because he got so interested in watching. Oh, he's all beat up inside, too. Got so interested in watching what was happening right in front of him there with Sed and Biffle.
He's right in front of Jack Sprague, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, we were going to say, if it's up to Sprague to carry the bow tie hopes today, he's got some lugging to do. Here we'll get a look at the side. Yeah, see, Tolsman's all beat up in the right-hand side, too.
And his truck is still running okay because he's standing in front of Sprague, so evidently he was off the course someplace.
Tolsma had cracked the top five, was part of that battle, struggling to get around Boris Sed. That battle has been broken up by the contretemps between Greg Biffle and Boris. And so your running order finds Hornaday at the front, then Biffle, then Ruckman, Sed in fourth spot, and awaiting the Sauter truck to arrive next. If we were to take a look at the championship points, if the race ended right now, Hornaday would gain a position over Sprague. Ruttman, Sauter, and Compton would all... actually, Ruttman and Sauter would pick up positions. Compton would lose a couple. Biffle would love to see the Jigger play.
He gained eight positions in the Craftsman Century's point standings. And then we see, as he tries to close in on the back bumper of Ron Hornaday, there's his teammate, Ruttman. There's the Dorsey Schrader automobile.
Boris Sed's had a tough time of it here today. Take you back through the field as we take a commercial break at Watkins Glen. We've had a couple of incidents. It was Kevin Harvick's off-road excursion that brought the pace truck back out, and there sits the Spears entry pretty well stuck in the gravel. He's not going to drive it out of there.
This is the inner loop up in turn five, and you're right. Once you get in that, you just can't drive it out.
Here comes the tow truck to pull him out. He was 25th on the racetrack when this happened, and it was the second incident, as we said. The other involved the 84 of Wayne Anderson, who's kind of been up and down the ladder here today.
As Lance Nard goes in the corner, and then we see the wheel hop Anderson. Now he's off in the grass, and Lance, and I'm sure glad I was able to get by. Then we see... We see the Sprague's been able to catch up with the field. He and Tolsma both. And there's Wayne Anderson, the Porter Cable truck.
Locked up the brakes going into the interloop. That's what sent him turning. Anderson, the son of the legendary Dick Anderson, sort of the Dick Trickle of Florida, won something like 1,000 features on the short tracks down south. Wayne told me yesterday that some days he looks in the mirror and thinks, you know what? My dad ought to have this ride. I think might still be a better race driver than I am. Pretty high praise. But then when you consider the fact that last year at Greenville Pickens, Wayne had a conflicting date, went up north to run a Busch North race. Dad got in the truck, started last, blitzed through, and won the race. So I guess it is a pretty good race driver. Here's Tolsma. Marty, you got more on what's up with him? He was inside the top five. Now he's in the back.
You guys were right. He did have contact. The crew says he didn't tell him who, but it spun him all the way around, sent him off, and that's why he's at the back of the pack. Another update, when you see the 52 of Mike Wallace, he was up to 10th, but he has fallen back to 15th. He's got second gear transmission problems.
That's going to make for a long day. You need to have the gearbox working for you rather than against you. The cleanup here was brief. All they had to do was drag Harvick out of the gravel trap in order to get this track race ready again. So we'll be set to resume. The nearly 2.5 second lead that Hornaday had on one occasion over Biffle will now be reduced to a couple truck lengths. Greg Biffle, who started this season in such magnificent fashion with top five finishes in the first two races, Orlando and Homestead, fifth and fourth respectively, then crashed at Phoenix and struggled at Portland and Monroe, and I guess actually at Lake Odessa too, 26th, 17th, and 24th in three races. But looks like he's back on track to they haven't cleared him yet. I wondered about that. Benny, he's back on track to have a good run here today, and I am most impressive with the fact that he's able to do it on this kind of a racetrack. Yeah. Got another look here at how Harvick got in trouble.
Just getting in the inner loop, gets the truck out of shape and spins into the gravel. And as we said, once you get in, you simply cannot drive out. It just, the truck mires up in the gravel too much. There's our field summary, our NAPA field summary. Check out where your favorite truck driver is running.
Sauter's been kind of cool, calm, and collected all weekend and has moved from 11th to 4th. I think you'll see a good day from him perhaps here today. Crawford from 18th to 9th has probably passed more trucks than anybody else in the top 10. And Schrader has cracked the top 10 from 15th starting spot, so he's having a good run. How about Hensley? 33rd to 12th? Wow. Jimmy's a legendary road racer, of course. Or so the press release said that they sent out it with the press release writer's tongue firmly in cheek. Pick your favorite. Take a look all the way back through the field as we're under yellow here with 28 laps complete. Working on 29.
Our boys back in the truck room has solved the mystery. I would see Kevin Harvick gets his truck out of the gravel pit. They've solved the mystery as to what happened to Randy Tolsma. There we see. Remember the crash between Biffle, or the contact between Biffle and Boris Said? There we see the contact. Now look behind as they come off this corner, as they go in turn 7. Look right behind. There we see Randy Tolsma and Mike Bliss, both of those trucks spinning out. And Tolsma was fortunate that he did not get in the gravel and lose a lap being towed out.
And it's pretty obvious that Bliss and Tolsma, the former rivals of the Silver Crown Division, went off in there thinking, look at them boys with fenders beating on each other. Ain't that something, Randy? And the first thing you knew, they were both facing the wrong way. We'll take a commercial break and come back with more after a wild moment in the interview. Hey, we'll see the green to start lap 30. We're almost halfway here. Hornaday is your leader with Biffle in the second spot, and then Joe Rudman lined up third. Sauter is fourth, followed by the 98 of Rob Rizzo, who's having a heck of a run here today. We haven't talked much about Rob, and we've done him a disservice. He has kind of quietly and calmly marched his way up through the field. There's the yellow number 98 right there. There's the green in the air. We're back at it at Watkins Glen.
Man, what a jump Ron Hornaday got. It looks like thought Rudman was going to try to pass Biffle, but that's not the case. He was just trying to simply protect his position from three. The yellow truck we saw go by is Rob Rizzo.
How did Bliss manage to hang on to that, what was it, seventh or eighth starting spot after that earlier incident? I guess he was able to turn around and keep going. He is still inside the top 10, running in seventh spot as we get back to green flag action here at Watkins Glen. NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series approaching the mid-race break when they'll get an opportunity to service these trucks.
There we see the two truck of Mike Bliss pulling up right behind the 44 of Boris Said. We see Ricky Crawford, another guy that you don't put road racing in his resume either, right behind Mike Bliss. He's in eighth spot.
Crawford's having a good day here today. He's said he sat the crew down after the first four races and said, guys, we've experienced it all. We've broken parts. We've won a race. We've crashed, and we had a disappointing finish. We've done everything you can do now. Let's get in there and work 18 hours a day and get after the one that we want to do again, and that's win another race. Homestead was big for that bunch.
See Boris Sitt turn into turn 11, come down the start-finish line. It's Mike Bliss trying to get by him as well.
Boris does not have quite the truck he started with here. That truck was struggling a little bit before he had the incident with Biffle, and now I think he's doing his best to just try to hang on.
Crawford. Nicky Crawford, the circle bar truck stop, the blue truck off. Did not get in the sand pit, though. He's able to continue on. Falls in right behind Mike Wallace, that would be in the 15th spot.
So that cost him about, what, seven positions? But no more than that if he didn't hurt the tires, and it doesn't appear that he did. Crawford, a few truck teams based, maybe the only truck team based in Georgia. They're up in the Georgia Mountains. Rains and the number six truck of Colorado's Corelli. Here's what happened to Crawford.
There we see him going in the corner. I guess he and Mike Bliss, he was trying to get by Bliss. Maybe there's some contact. Maybe just simply got in the corner too hard. And that's very easy to do down in turn one.
And a scary place to do that, too. Here it is out the back of Boris Sett's truck.
Oh, he just got in the corner way, way too hard. And almost ran to the back. Mike Bliss. So, and he's trying, now he's trying to charge back to the front. He's on the inside. And we see Mike Bliss is on the inside of Forrest down in turn one. And he takes that spot away. The caution flag waves. Unfortunately, I'm afraid that pass will not work.
Forrest giving him plenty of room that time. Not wanting to do any additional damage to the number 44 truck. And the yellow should be for the mid-race break here rather than an incident. We have completed 31 laps. So this means it'll be an opportunity to service all of these trucks. Some need it worse than others. We're going to get the commercial break in and then come back to cover all of the halftime activity here as the crews prepare to go to work and shake these machines up for the second half of the Parts America 150. Stay with us. Back at Watkins Glen, the truck slowly making their way back around for the halftime break. There's your fifth place truck of Rob Rizzo, the New Yorker, who's having a great run here today. We got baseball, of course, coming up on ESPN. The Braves and the Cubs. The Braves consistent all-around play of Chipper Jones. You know, he's the third baseman and the power of Andre with the last name that I could ever pronounce. They're going to play tomorrow at 8 o'clock Eastern time on ESPN, so check it out. It's on TV, it's on radio, it's all over the place.
It's Galarraga.
Like I said, I can't pronounce that. Let's go down for the mid-race break with Marty.
And the guys are finally pulling into pit lane here, and we're going to try and make our way over the wall. We'll give everybody plenty of room, and we'll go on over to check in with Joe Rubin. Now, talking to the crew, they were just going to check tire wear. They were planning on not making any major changes to the chassis or pressures as everyone else is filing by. We're down towards pit in, and looking at the tire, I mean, it looks like they could have gone maybe another 10 more laps. As soon as the Jackman gets the car, truck all the way up, and we get the supports underneath. There, here we go. Let's go on in here and see if we can get in. Joe, so far so good.
I didn't copy that, but we're not quite right, and we're going to try to get her dialed in. So we're really excited about the old Excite thing running up here, and run out and buy some batteries, folks, and help me out.
All right. He got the plug in again. Always count on Joe. Now let's talk about Greg Biffle and the 50. Look at the wear on the side here. This is the contact with Boris Sitt. But also, Benny, want to throw this out to you because I was talking to Randy Goss, the crew chief. He says, man, I'm watching this truck crew through turn 11 and it looks tail happy. But yet Greg's telling me that it is just running like a charm. He says, I don't know what to do. He says, I'm going to take a look at the tires. What do you think?
I think that's exactly what they will do. They'll look at the tires. They'll check the air pressure in those tires, check the wear on them, and they'll adjust the truck according to that.
All right, let me see if I can duck in here real quick. Hey, Rook, you're doing pretty good.
Yeah, I'm doing. I'll just listen to the crew and just do it and try to keep my head on straight. Yeah, the truck's looking great. This Granger truck, Ford truck, is just awesome. I mean, these guys that worked so hard this weekend getting me tuned up here, and and a lot of them are from a road race crew, so that knowledge helped us a little bit. But most importantly, I had to do good today. Benny's watching me today. So I can't make any mistakes, but I feel pretty good about it.
You know, you were about 5 feet in the air coming through the inner loop in that contact.
Yeah, you know, I don't know. I can't say honestly what happened there is I went inside Boris, and he slowed down and gave me the group, you know, gave me the inside, and then turned me down into the curb, you know. But, I mean, I guess it's racing. I thought I damaged the truck, but they say it's okay. They checked the toe. Everything seems to be fine, so these things are pretty tough.
All right, that's Greg Biffle, guys.
He's got a heck of a run going there. Very fortunate to be in the position that he is after that run-in with Boris Sett. There's your fifth-place truck on the racetrack. That is Rob Rizzo, hometown Providence, Rhode Island. Lives in East Greenwich, Rhode Island now, and is best known for his Ray Bestas Rising Star Award in the 1995 Trans Am Series. In his first 12 starts, he had 5 top fives, and everybody went, whoa, this is the boy to watch. And then, of course, the Trans Am Series started to sputter a little bit, and he decided he wanted to try truck racing. He's got a great run going on here today. Fourth on the racetrack is the 3 truck. Let's get the report from Marty.
Yeah, last year Jay Sauter didn't have the kind of result he wanted here, but boy, same truck, and you're doing very well right now.
Well, I want to tell you what, these guys gave us a great Chevrolet today. This Goodwrench team has really done a good job on all their road courses, and we're just being patient, saving our tires, and having something to race with at the end.
Yeah, I'm looking around. I don't see a scratch on this thing. I mean, you're staying real clean.
Well, I'll tell you what, the money lap isn't until the end, and that's when we're going to be in the hunt.
So what changes did they make to the chassis setup?
Yeah, we're playing with the air pressure a little bit and maybe some spring changes. We'll see what happens.
You aren't going to take this guy along to the right here for a ride, are you?
No, it'd be fun for him, but it wouldn't be any good for me.
He is in here reaching underneath. I think he's trying to make an adjustment on one of the belts, but we'll let Jay and the crew take care of business. Let's mosey on back to the number 2 truck right here behind us as Mike Bliss is running in 7th. He has got some damage on the left front panel. You can see a tire swipe here. Mike, 7th place so far. You still got some time.
Yeah, the AC4 is running strong. We got down into the inner loop there and tangled with the 61. It was just, you know what happens down there, and we tangled and we got going, and it's going to be better. We're a little bit tight right now.
Yeah, the inner loop is not an exclusive club today, as we have found out.
No, it's a place where a big wreck's going to happen sometimes, and sometimes you just do it, you run into each other there.
Well, these guys are finishing up the work. Guys, we'll send it back up to you.
Well, of course, they were the second bunch to run into each other. The first bunch were much more spectacular. Here's the incident that we're talking about. The inner loop, the chicane. At the end of this long run, you're on board with Bliss. There's Biffle up front, and then there's Bliss into the side of Tolesman.
And we see he just puts it in gear and drives away, so he only lost a couple of spots. He was very forcing in that contact.
Gosh, I would ask Benny who was responsible for all that, who hit who, but the little bird is telling me in my ear, we have to take this commercial break. Parsons, you lucked out again. Dodge, ready to go. We come back to Watkins Glen International Raceway. There goes Bob pulling out. He's having a pretty tough weekend as we take the Dodge race recap for you here and find that Hornaday has led virtually the entire day. The lead changes primarily, Benny, the result of the early pit stops. A couple of cautions have kept the average speed down, and it's been a pretty interesting race with the exception, I guess, of Hornaday kind of dominating it out front.
Yeah, Hornaday just has been out front. No one has been able to pass him, but there has been some great racing going on in the back behind for third on back.
Reffner and Dobson both led it as a result of pit stop strategy. Boris said led from the pole after the initial pole sitter. This guy, Ron Fellows, popped the fuel pump and dropped out. That, after he missed the driver's meeting, had started tailing the field. So, for said, it was the opportunity to lead the first few laps, and then he has kind of gone backward through the field after a couple of big tangles, most notably the one that we saw just before the commercial break with the number 50 of Greg Biffle. Field working their way back into position for the restart to start the second half of the race, which will again have the mandatory pit stop. So we'll see a bit more of that pit strategy playing its part here. Rough road for Boris Sett, I would say so. 97 in road racing. Note that the better he started, the worse he finished, and the other way around. Here at Watkins Glen, they had an unusual week as he had to start at the back of the field, came through, actually got further up the field at 11th, but that's where he wound up. So a
don't know what the secret's going to be for Boris, but he hasn't found it yet.
Well, they might be able to work on that. I'm sure they made some changes to that Federated Auto Parts truck during the break, and he may be able to go to the front.
We'll see how much they were able to straighten out the body panels on the side of it. All the damage from the Biffle incident was on the opposite side from that camera shot. Hey, he's not doing bad. He's in sixth spot here as we prepare for the restart, which will come shortly. And Marty, anything that the guys decided as a result of the first segment fuel strategy that might play into the second segment, what are we going to see these guys do?
Well, I went down and talked to Fred Graves at the pit out at the other end of where we were. I said, well, what changes to make? He said, none, really. The truck's running fine. I said, what about fuel strategy? He said, well, we might stop a lap or two earlier than we did the last time. If you remember, they stayed out a little bit longer than everybody else. And I would not be surprised, guys, if you see a bunch of guys come in, top off, and get right back out on the racetrack. Whoever goes first, I think you're going to see a flood of guys follow.
Wasn't a huge issue in the first half. I can't say that anybody's strategy had a huge impact on the outcome.
That's because the caution flag did not fall in the middle of the pit stops.
There you go. He just has a way of summing things up in a few words so nicely. Watch Rubman go after Biffle on this restart. He tried it on the last restart, and it didn't happen. We'll see if he does it again now as they come back down and prepare to get the green flag in the air. Here you are further back in the field as we prepare for the restart for the second half of this Parts America 150 at Watkins Glen, New York. We're looking at the back of Tony Raines in 11th spot, and there's the flag.
And once again, the 16 truck of Hornaday gets that great jump on Biffle.
He is the master of the restart, and he's made it work again quickly, extending a 5-6 truck length lead. Past series champ, Ron Hornaday.
Pirelli though to the inside of the 19 truck. And you see Barsett trying to get by Rob Rizzo. This is right along with Barsett. That's Rizzo, the Hastings Fielder truck in front of him. A battle for the fifth spot.
These guys would have done some Trans Am racing together before. Probably right here at Watkins Glen. Boris has more laps, I guess, on this racetrack than anybody else out there. Trouble for Hensley.
He's sitting in pits. He made his pit stop during the break and has not gone back out.
Jimmy was as high as 10th from a provisional starting spot here. So it had been a good day for the Richard Petty-owned Dodge, but it's all apparently gone for naught now as the hood is up. Well, Biffle is there, ready to attack the tailgate of Ron Hornaday. I thought Rutland might have a shot at him there on that restart. That didn't happen. Instead, Biffle has moved back within a truck length of the leader here. One of the dominant drivers in the history of the series leads as a bunch of them go to pit road.
Joe Rutman, the third-place truck. We see Jay Sauter was running in fourth place. Into the pits they come for that splash of gas. I don't even know if they splash gas. And now he's trying to get out. And
he got into the back of Corelli. Man.
And all the pit road is full of trucks making that mandatory pit stop.
Marty called it. It was a wholesale blitz to pit road. Corelli needing a push after the tangle with Rutman. Hornaday stayed out, so did Biffle, and behind them, it was Coxey's Army heading for the pits. All they have to do is stop. They don't have to put any gas in. Rutman had it perfectly. Got in, stopped. They just kind of pointed the gas can at it, but then he hit Corelli as he was trying to leave.
And that had to cost him about a second, I would guess.
Here comes the battle for the lead. Will these guys perhaps come to pit road this time by? Might Biffle let Hornaday go in hopes of leading a lap? I don't see that there'd be much profit in that strategy.
No, I don't think so either. Let's see. Will they come down pit road? They certainly do not want to get caught with that caution flag. They stayed on the racetrack once again.
Hornaday, the veteran, leading the youngster Biffle down the start-finish line, past the start-finish line. Rizzo also stayed out and is now third.
Morissette's coming down pit road.
Marty.
Well, Barisette is going to bring it in, as well as a few others. The reason the 16 truck is staying out, I asked Fred, I said, why not come in with the conglomerate? And he says, we need a few laps. I'm really worried.
Left, it all the left, go,
this
go,
could
go.
Go green the rest of the way. We might end up short.
We mentioned at one point that different teams have different
much in terms of their fuel mileage capability, and that's the reason they implemented the mandatory stop. In the case of Hornaday, there was a real need for some fuel. Rutman, the Roush bunch, known for fuel mileage on the truck, didn't figure they needed any gas, so they stopped early. Question now will be how many laps, and will Biffle in a Roush truck come with him? I would think so, to keep his racing point.
You're probably right, and if Rutman can make it the rest of the way, you think that Biffle can make it the rest of the way. And once again, they stay on the racetrack, run yet another lap. I'm telling you, the caution flag comes out during this lap. These two trucks will go back to about 15th, 20th place. We see the third place truck of Rizzo coming in. Now, Terry Cook has moved up to fourth.
Rizzo says, I'm not playing this game any longer. I'm going to get on pit road. Marty.
Yeah, Rizzo is going to bring it down. This guy has done an excellent job. Remember, in the morning practice, he was the quickest race truck out there on the last practice session. And a little bit longer. They want to make sure they topped it off, but he's back out and underway.
He's run only one other truck race this year, Ron Rizzo. That was at Homestead, and he was 30th. He's known as a road racer. Ooh, trouble for Roper. He's going behind the wall. Tony Roper out of Fairgrove, Missouri. Dean Roper's son. Looks like he's done for the day. Here we go back to the front of the field. Hornaday's opened it back up to a couple of truck lengths. Biffle continuing to shadow him, and they're all alone out there now.
And they are really playing with fire. They, the longer they stay on the racetrack. And we see Hornaday waving. He says, I'm going in the pits, and Biffle will have to follow him because they're really playing with fire. Truck being pushed on pit road. I sure hope that none of these two are pitted by that truck.
Well, Hornaday's all the way down toward that end, but I think
it's going to
be okay.
Gear.
There's the warning about the speed limit. 3,800 in first gear gets you 35 miles an hour.
Run a free spread.
Biffle stops at the other end. Hornaday's got to run the ninth to pit road.
Going to be interesting here is we'll find out who can get out quicker, and it looks like it's going to be Biffle if he doesn't get caught for speeding. Here comes the stop, and we're watching Biffle come by.
1,002.
That's Fred
Graves.
And Biffle's going to beat him out.
2 seconds worth of fuel is what they needed. They came in virtually together. Ooh, somebody has hit hard. Kevin Harvick is into the foam barrier.
Boy, did those good guys stop at the right time or not, because this is going to bring out the caution flag. One more lap, and they would have been back in about 20th spot as the caution flag waves.
Man, Harvick has hit a ton. As you can see, the front end is all crumpled up. They put those foam barriers there for a reason. And so as Kevin regroups there, I see the truck being fired back up. We were waiting for the window net to come down. He says, I'm trying to figure out how to drive away from this mess. Can't see so well. Second incident of the day for Harvick. Let's see how this one happened.
This is going in turn one. We see him get in the corner. Just got in simply too hard, and he goes through the gravel. You know, the last time he got stuck in the gravel, this time maybe he said he wanted to go through there harder. Well, he went in there too hard.
I tell you what, that is a place that you do not want to go off. That is a very, very fast piece of road right there, and it got away from Harvick. Take a look from Keselowski's on.
Man.
The barrier did its job. He's got sheet metal damage, but nothing more. Kevin Harvick has put it back under yellow at the perfect moment for Hornaday, and the guy's chasing him. Youngsters from opposite ends of the racing world. Kevin Harvick here from the West Coast has smashed up the Spears number 75, as you see, and that is the reason we are under caution here at Watkins Glen, New York. Meanwhile, Rob Rizzo, who was fifth at the time of the yellow flag, which Harvick brought out, was caught guilty of speeding on pit road, and he has disappeared from the top five. So we take a look at how they're going here. Now, Miller, Anderson, Norick, Walters, and Keselowski have not yet stopped. Again, you think of taking advantage under the yellow, but it is not an advantage in this circumstance to pit under the yellow. Way back in the field is Rizzo after the penalty. He's going to have to go to the back. We saw Roper dropping out there just before the yellow flag came out. So a big break there for the number 16 of Ron Hornaday and the number 50 of Greg Biffle. There is Rizzo, who's going to have to pass an awful lot of trucks here in a hurry. Let's
Let's get a report from Marty.
Well, Kevin Harvick's made it back to pit lane. There's water coming out of the radiator, and all the duct work to the brakes. This is going to be a terminal situation because the radiator has got severe damage to it, guys. But amazingly, if they wouldn't have had that styrofoam down there, we've been here when we've seen crashes. If he'd have gone in head first there without that, just straight in the Armco, that all would have been smashed back into the cockpit area. So the foam did its job.
We're going to seize the opportunity for a quick commercial break. Greg Biffle is sitting in front of Hornaday, is now at the tail end of this yellow. The rest of those guys are going to pit, and that's going to move Boris Sett up into third position when we come back. We're back at Watkins Glen, New York, on the 50th birthday of this grand old racetrack up in the Northeast. The golf folks, meanwhile, are in Columbus, Ohio. ABC's coverage of the Memorial Tournament. Jack Nicklaus, Pride and Joy, will start today live at 4 o'clock Eastern Time. Jack's won the thing a couple of times. Who is that guy there, Benny?
That's Tiger Woods.
Tiger Woods, that's right. He's in it along with Nicklaus and Leonard and Love and all the rest of those guys. So you want to catch the golf at 4 o'clock.
I don't know if Justin Leonard made the cut or not.
Oh, is that a fact?
Davis
sure
Love.
I wouldn't have put this on my promo copy if you were to the show. That's not possible, is it?
I think Lynn Matisse was the leader after the second round going in today's third round.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, too. You'd know that. You follow that golf stuff. You're out there hitting them all the time. Here's our leader, but I'm wondering for how long. Biffle, the kid, is in front of Hornaday, the master of the restart. What do you think is going to happen?
Well, I tell you one thing. Greg is being hurt on the restarts, all the restarts today. Hornaday's been able to get that big jump. We see the light still on atop the pace trucks. Will not go green this time.
And I could not begin to tell you why that is. We were anticipating the restart, but that'll give Biffle a little more time to think about it. You saw that he had gone from sixth to the lead, and this was in part because he simply followed Hornaday, who started fourth today and is currently second on the racetrack, but has been the dominant truck and had led it most of the way. Now we're getting radio reports that there's some oil on the racetrack.
Well, Harvick, I saw him driving in, and all that smoke you didn't think was tire smoke. He must have been losing some oil, and I guess that they've got to put the oil dried around this racetrack. I'm sure we get rid of that oil.
So we'll spend a little longer here under the caution as we await that restart. It's been kind of a fun weekend for Ron Hornaday, and not all the fun has involved the action on the racetrack. Yesterday, they had a big day for the kids here. No, it was not school bus racing. It was an opportunity to skip school and come to the racetrack and hang out with famous race car drivers. And Hornaday thought that this was just big fun because all these kids thought he was the greatest thing to come along in a long time. Listen to him. Get the big hit. Ron had fun. The kids had fun. And it was a whole lot cooler than when I was in fifth grade and field trip meant you went to the public library. There is a connection, though. In order to be eligible for the field trip, the kids had to read 25 books.
That's pretty good.
That's awesome, isn't it?
David's giving the tour of the transporter that hauls this Napa Brakes truck around the country.
Good deal for the kids from Kent Phillips truck. Hornaday, get the restart. We're going to run them around while they clean up the racetrack, and then we'll see if Hornaday can jump back out in front of this deal and obviously gain substantial advantage in terms of the points, or at least potentially here, Benny, with Sprague sitting back there in seventh spot. Although, all things considered, I expect Sprague pretty happy to be seventh.
He'd have to be tickled to death to be there.
He had a pushing truck, he's got the flu, he had a flat tire, and he's still inside the top 10. More on him when we come back. We're back at Watkins Glen, New York. It's the Parts America 150, the third road race for the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series up here at Watkins Glen. Hornaday winning the inaugural, and then Ron Fellows last year. Fellows having a tough day today, combination of being late for the driver's meeting and then breaking the fuel pump. He is out of the event, the defending champion no longer with us, and perhaps now we have a problem for the leader of the race. Let's find out more about that as we go to Marty Reed.
Yeah, talk to Randy Goss. He says he's not sure. Greg says he's either possibly got a transmission problem, a rear end problem, but Randy thinks he may be getting wheel hop. Despite all that, Randy went to NASCAR officials, says, please let the 16 truck know that we may have a problem and may be slow on the restart through turn 11. We don't want to start a chain reaction deal.
Now we're getting ready for that restart here as Biffle leads him back around. Randy Goss, of course, the former Grand National Motorcycle Champion, will be inducted into the Dirt Track Motorcycle Hall of Fame on Labor Day weekend at Springfield, Illinois. Congratulations to him. You see the sheet metal damage on the side of Biffle's truck. Here we come to the green.
Go, go, go!
Room. Now let's see what happens.
Could not quite make it as we see Mike Wallace on the outside. Made it through the corner, okay.
Wow.
That's Jack Sprague trying to get by Hornaday, the pure, I mean, by Wallace.
Sprague in seventh spot with Wallace right in front of him. Or check that, eighth and seventh. Wallace is seventh and Sprague is eighth.
Here's their favorite place to pass. Let's see, Hornaday looks, can't quite make it. Meanwhile, behind Joe Rutland trying to get by Sauter. He will. Oh, and Biff, something happened to Biffle. Coming off the court, looks like the transmission broke in the Granger truck.
Well, apparently the analysis was correct, and there was a problem in the drivetrain of Biffle's truck. It was good for less than a lap after the restart. Hornaday will retake the lead with Boris Sett second and Joe Rutman third. Sometimes you just cannot buy a break in this business.
Man, oh man, too bad for Biffle.
Two top five finishes in the first two races for the rookie out of the Pacific Northwest. Since then, nothing but trouble. And it's continued here today at Watkins Glen. Big shuffle back in the positions involving Barfield. The 35, you saw him get run all the way down against the pit road
as he gets by Randy Tolsma.
Crawford steps out of line and will pick up a position from the 19 of Reigns, and that is for the last spot in the top 10. Crawford will move inside the top 10. So the 50 is stopped and Marty is there.
Yeah, and just like the situation with Dominic Dobson, the team has a transmission and a differential ready to go as they are getting the left side of the truck up first, then they'll get the right side up, then they'll take a determination, and we'll let you know exactly which one it ends up being.
Cintas rookie points, of course, are the issue here for Greg Biffle as he's involved in that battle with Andy Houston and Wayne Anderson, actually leading the two of them by 3 points as they came into the event here today. And Biffle was qualified up in the front of the field. The other two qualified in the back, but now it looks like he'll finish in the back, and the jury is still out on the other two guys. Actually, Houston's having a great run here. He's in 14th position after starting on a provisional. As for Wayne Anderson, let's see, 21st spot.
And Boris Sid is much better in that Federated truck than he was earlier.
It's like the 30.
Looks like the adjustments they made during the break are helping him because he's closed up right on the back of the 16 of Hornaday.
We mentioned Sprague. He's solid in seventh. Picked up one position here since the restart. Sprague nursing a 23-point lead over Hornaday. Hornaday holding the advantage you see on your screen there over the second place Boris Sett. His first NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series race. Everybody figured it would come on a road course.
And we saw the last lap, Boris Sett was in fact faster than Ron Hornaday by about a tenth of a second.
Big run down the straightaway. A lot of speed here at Watkins Glen. It is a very fast racetrack. It's not just the long straightaways. Corners very, very quick. You don't want to go off. On left hand, one, only two on the racetrack where we saw Harvick get off over there. Real quick.
And we see the 61 truck of Brandon Tolsma smoking that right front tire. He slid the brake trying to get position on Ron Barfield's new auto truck.
Couldn't get around him.
Battle for the eighth spot. Tolsma once again trying to get to turn one. He now takes his spot away in. Ricky Crawford said, let me get on the inside. Let me.
I better not try it here. So for Tolsma, it continues to be a great road race here. He's in eighth spot. He had an excellent truck last week at Odessa. You say, what? Tolsma? I don't know. He's like 30th in the results. Well, he got a valve stem knocked off in the first, I don't know, half dozen laps or so. Went 2 laps down. Came back later in the race, lined up sixth on the restart. Those 2 laps
see Ricky Crawford able to get by the 35 of Barfield. So good run today for Rick Crawford.
Tolsma's going to close in now on Jack Sprague in the 24, the championship series leader. There they come. Just in front of Crawford, who has now moved up to ninth. Barfield will move to the tail end of the top 10. Sprague's been up and down the ladder today, as you see in that graphic. The first leg problems, including a bad push and then a flat tire.
I think that push problem still persists.
Commercial break coming up as Ron Hornaday leads
705.
And Sprague tries to hang on.
Balloon we're seeing, that's the hood of Rick Corelli's truck, so evidently he has lost a transmission. Brian Rafter is right behind, and we see in front of him Rick Corelli smoking, and he now has that truck to the pits. Meanwhile, back to the front.
Battle continues. Hornaday out front being pursued by Boris Said and Joe Ruttman. You're looking out the back to see Ruttman, and there in front is the leader, Hornaday, both from the view of Boris Said, who sits in second spot. And for more on his story, we go to Marty.
Yeah, I talked with Jay Smith, the crew chief, and he told me that in the first half of the race, Boris was loose. They tightened it up. It's a little tighter than Boris would like it right now, but obviously not hurting him enough as he is closing in on Ron Hornaday.
Who used the phrase sometime in the last couple of weeks, loosen her up with a gas pedal? Stand on the gas and slide her around a little bit. Well, I tell you, that's a tough way to do it, though. I know who it was. It was Lafleur talking about his qualifying lap on Thunder the other night.
Back in fourth place is Mike Bliss, who had that big crash on Thursday during practices in the backup truck. Qualified well, is now up to fourth spot.
Fourth after spinning is not bad.
I love this camera we've got on the left front. Look how red hot the brake rotor gets as he comes through turn 11. Now when he gets to the straightaway, we'll see that suspension just calm down. Now then, he goes in turn one, woo, turns right hard, and look at the tread of the tire. It just flops around the sidewall. How flimsy it seems to be. Watch as he makes that right. Now he's going back to the left up on top, and he'll turn left. There you go. Now he's got to go back to the right just a little bit as he goes down the backstretch. Now, you're going to get about 150, 60 miles per hour. You're going to really see that brake rotor turn red as he...
Right there, because he's on the brake so hard going into the interloop. And then flick, and then back out. The view of the work of the right front tire of Mike Bliss.
Left front tire,
along with the suspension and the brakes and all the rest.
And there are the first four cars, trucks, I should say.
This after a spin, after the tangle with Tolsma earlier today. Tolsma, by the way, is seventh. So both of these guys have recovered nicely from that incident. And remember, that incident happened right behind the 44 of Boris Said, who is second on the race track. Biffle, who is leading the thing, and he dropped out with a transmission problem.
We heard Barry Dodson say that he ran 1:17:20. That's a minute 17.20. And the leaders ran 1:17:15. So that lap, Bliss was 0.05 of a second slower than the 16 truck.
There you see your top four, plus Sauter, who rounds out the top five, and then take you on further back. Sprague, Tolsma, Crawford moving up through the top 10. Barfield hanging on to the tail end of the top 10. Mark Simo having a good run in the sister truck to Boris Said. He is the team owner, of course, and only a part-time racer. Schrader has gone nowhere, and that surprises me. He's running right about where he started. Reffner's been to the top of the heap, led a lap, then fell back. Rizzo had the speeding ticket that dropped him back, but he's moving back forward. He is now 18th and was all the way at the tail end of the field. Anderson, likewise, has developed some consistency here, having started from a provisional, now sitting in 20th. Keselowski's gone forward. Walters in his very first truck race. And then the guys who've had trouble. Corelli's been under the hood. Biffle's got the transmission problem. Harvick crashed a couple of times. Roper went behind the wall early with mechanical difficulties. Hensley broke. Morgan broke. Fellows, Pompadour, and Dodson was the first truck out. laps into the 61 lap distance here at Watkins Glen, New York.
And Leverson Marcino dived to the inside of Tony Raines, taking the spot away, moves up to 11th place now.
We call him a part-time racer. That's because he has a very successful business to run full-time, but he's a veteran of the Trans Am Series and a very capable shooter, as you've seen by his performance here today, moves into 11th spot. Raines says, hey, 12's not bad. I'm not in the fence.
Off the corner, accelerates, and there we see Ron Barfield, Mark Simo right behind him, Tony Raines, and Mike Wallace, the truck right in front of them.
Wallace may have been the most consistent day of anybody out there. He's pretty well just stayed parked right where he is there in that ninth spot. Hasn't been out of the top 10 much today through all the shuffling, the pit stops, the mandatory pit stops. Those, by the way, are all history now. Everybody has stopped for their fuel. They did it early. The thing has cycled back around, and the dominant truck all day continues to lead. That's Hornaday.
Never seen a Pure Later Chevy of Mike Wallace. Kenny Schrader's truck.
Barfield's doing a good job hanging with him. Barfield doesn't have much road racing experience.
Now, from Florence, South Carolina, you don't learn much about road racing on the flat roads around the Low Country of South Carolina.
Do a little sand racing.
This is sponsored by Ortho. Truck owned by Charles Hardy. Tell you what, Morris is hanging right there with Hornaday. He's not able to close in on the back level, but he's right there with him.
As bad as that truck's beat up, he's doing a nice job with it. Aerodynamics, not that big an issue here. And Boris says, I don't care what it looks like. I care where we are in the running order. We'll be right back. America 150 and continues to do so here with 51 laps in the book and 10 to go. Want to mention, oh, look at that. The NHL logo in front of that truck as we plug the Stanley Cup playoffs. Eastern Conference Finals, Game 4 coming up. I offered Benny the opportunity to pronounce the names of some of the players, but he says he doesn't do Russian, so we'll tell you it's the Washington Capitals and the Buffalo Sabres, and it starts at 7:30 tonight, so check it out. Playoff time for the hockey players and the basketball guys, and meanwhile, great racing action at Watkins Glen. This is for sixth spot as Jack Sprague continues to try to hold off Randy Tolsman. Tolsman's taken a couple of pretty good shots at him lately.
Sure has. We see Ricky Crawford back there. I'm really impressed by Rick Crawford. In eighth spot,
here is Jack Sprague today. Are you just kind of cutting your losses and figuring I got to get out of here without wrecking the truck?
Exactly. Right now, you just want to take whatever you can get because it's not been a particularly good day. The truck has not been handling that well. Had a flat tire.
Hornaday wins the thing. Then Sprague has to finish fourth or better to hang on to that 23-point lead, and that means he would have to pick up two spots, moving ahead of Sauter and Bliss in the lineup as they run right now with about 10 to go.
There we see it once again, a Napa field summary. You can check out where your favorite truck driver is running.
Top five hasn't changed much. Bragan Tolsma, Crawford picking up a position. A couple of segments ago. Doesn't do the truck series that often.
Once again, there is the leaders. First four go by. There's Jay Sauter, a fifth place truck. And then we saw just a moment ago the battle between the 24 and 61. There's Rick Crawford. Now, here's a pretty good battle between Mike Wallace, Mark Simo, and Simo dives to the inside. Hey, Mike, he's on the inside back there.
Yeah, that's the place where you better let him go. That's not the place to outbrave somebody right there. So, Simo continuing his march, moves up to ninth.
And Tony Raines, meanwhile, is right behind the 35 of Ron Barfield. Raines is in the 12th spot.
The cast of players in front of his onboard camera continues to change and shuffle, but he's sitting there pretty solidly in 12th spot. Reigns, that's not bad. He's one of the guys that Benny mentioned at the top of the show. Just a sophomore in the series, but sixth in the points. And coming off the win at I-70, 12th here would be a victory.
Listen to him. Play with the throttle. He come off the corner. See, the earlier you just wait and accelerate off that corner, the faster you're going to go. But it's a very difficult thing to do.
How much of that is driver skill and knowing what he's doing, and how much of it is the way your truck's behaving?
I think most of it is the way the truck's behaving.
You get on it too quick, and push it over.
Yep. Oh, here we go. Reigns is going to dive to the inside of Barfield. No, can't quite make it. Had to back off, hit the brakes, and we see, just touching the brakes, Barfield jumped out about three truck lengths on him.
Barfield knows he's there now. Action back in the pack as Simo continues to operate the main spot. And we got a strong move into the top 10.
We got to give a call to Randy McDonald in that 06 Dodge truck. I mean, that guy is in 13th spot right on the back bumper of Tony Reigns. And a great, great run today for McDonald.
He was the top qualified Dodge, but that was back in 17th spot. So he's done a fine job today in keeping himself out of trouble and going forward.
Rob Rizzo continues to work back to the front, back to 14th spot.
So he was, what, 18th, I guess, the last time we had a rundown on that. So he's getting back some of what he lost. Rizzo had been inside the top five. Shows how you do not want to speed. Cost you $100 on the highway, cost you 10 spots here.
Which is thousands.
Back of the field. That's a bunch of money. Yeah, $331,000, I think, on the line here today at Watkins Glen this afternoon. Meanwhile, up front, not much change in this picture. Hornaday continues to lead, and Boris continues to stalk him as we get down close to the end of the Parts America 150. On the road, getting out from the dirt with five to go. Feeling the pressure, perhaps, from last time across dark connection was a second and a quarter. And that's about what it looks like this time. Opens up the tap, perhaps, to try to get away from Boris. Boris has won four times this year in road race competition. No, not in the trucks. At Daytona in the 24-hour, Sebring in the 12-hour, in Las Vegas in sports car competition, and also Memorial Day in the GT2 race up at Lime Rock Park, Connecticut. So he's having a good year. Now he's trying to cap it with a truck victory. Jump on board with Mike Bliss. Watch the brakes.
He's going through the S's now. We're on the backstretch, and we'll see the left front kind of calm down. Now he's on the brakes hard, going in the inner loop. Turns right. Now turns back to the left. Now back to the right. Boy, that suspension takes such a beating as he goes through that inner loop.
Bouncing off the tiger's teeth and using up all the road and the brakes. Mike Bliss in fourth spot.
And Rizzo is on the inside of Barfield. Takes it away.
Into 11th. Charging. Making up for the lost time. He'll get a couple more here if he hurries.
And Randy McDonald, the 06. We saw him just a moment ago. He has passed Tony Reigns. Taking that spot away.
Reigns kind of going backward a little bit here. Has slipped to 14th spot. He was 12th. Rizzo, one of the guys who has moved by. Stop and go penalty put him all the way at the tail end of the field. But he has driven magnificently here today. And only his second start of the year.
And here we see Randy McDonald, the Amsoil truck, trying to make a run on Barfield. He dives to the inside, trying his best to beat him to the next corner.
Got a shot at it.
He does. And meanwhile, back to Andy Houston, is trying to dive on the inside of the 19 of Tony Reigns. Could not quite make that pass.
Now, Andy didn't quite get the position that McDonald did, so McDonald will pull off the pass. Barfield tries to retaliate all this right in front of Reigns in the 19. But disappearing from Reigns' view. I think Reigns' truck's gone south. Yeah, he doesn't seem to have a truck he had five laps ago.
Now, Rizzo closing right on the back of Mike Wallace. We'll try to dive to the inside, outbreak him in the inner loop, and looks like he'll make that pass.
Drive. Dad owns a big car dealership, and they jumped into this truck series. The Rizzo family tried to do it as a family operation, and they said, well, maybe this isn't the way to do this. So now he's become a hired gun, and today he's showing he's worth the money. He's into the top 10. Three to go.
Obviously, the 98 truck is the truck that Kenny Irwin used to run. Liberty Racing,
this year's sponsorship from Hastings Filter.
Kenny is drawn on to the Winston Cup Wars to drive for Robert Yates. Winston Cup at Dover this weekend. The championship battle's on the front row, in case you haven't heard. Up for grabs between these two in the waning laps of the Parts America 150 at Watkins Glen, New York. Nobody has had much for Hornaday. If Seth's going to throw something at it, he better do it quick.
And Barfield off the course, and Tony Raines gets by. Barfield got in the corner just a little bit too hard, ran up on the strip, the rumble strips, and lost the spot. And double behind you right now, Ronnie, but there's a couple of guys behind you.
Up the hill they come. One of those guys is Schrader. We jump on board with him in the Ice House truck owned by Tom Gloy. As they head for the inner loop, he'll gain some on the brakes, I bet. Back out the other side. Barfield gets it all back on acceleration.
Meanwhile, Ron Hornaday has gone by the start finish line. Two laps to go. There you see going out of turn one. And now he's moved out to about a 2.5 second advantage on Morissette.
Morris doesn't have anything for him, I don't think. And Sprague sitting back there in sixth spot is going to, or is at least in danger of giving up the point lead here with less than two laps to go. Here's your third place truck of Ruttman. And the gap back to Mike Bliss in fourth position. Again, you talked about feeling like a victory after riding off a truck here in practice. The difficulty they've had in the last couple of weeks. Oh, problem for Anderson. He's looped it for the second incident of the day with a quarter cable truck. And that may mean caution and a one-lap shootout. Sure enough, he is in the way. So they're going to throw the yellow and give Sed one last chance.
Wow. These races don't end on the caution flag, do they?
That's a fact.
Oh, wow.
They've got to go.
So we are going to see a restart. Ron Hornaday's got to pull off that magic one more time.
He's the toughest guy in the world to pass on a restart. But Seth'll get his shot.
And that's all you can ask for is a shot. This is up in turn nine.
Hornaday comes by and says, what'd you do that for?
That's turn 11. I'm sorry. Comes down to the start finish line. There we see the back of his car, Wayne Anderson's car, as we see the caution flag waving, and the race should be over.
Almost made it back around. Let's see how it happened.
Comes off the corner and just smokes that left front tire, gets in the corner a little bit too hard, and oh, now he blew up. That's what happened. He lost an engine going in that corner. And the oil gets under the tires, and away he goes. Right on the left-hand side of your screen, you see the smoke, and pretty soon it's going to really smoke. As he goes out of the shot,
that's a bad break for Wayne, who is in the battle for the Cintas Rookie of the Year championship. In fact, was tied for second coming in, but the guy who leads it has already broken in front of him. So I guess the upshot of all that is probably that Andy Houston is going to come out with a substantial lead in that battle. He is 16th on the racetrack and the only one still running. We're going to take a look at how the field line up here as we run past our intended broadcast window. We will stay with us to the finish as Hornaday leads over Sed, with Ruttman, Bliss, and Sauter rounding out the top five. Sprague, your championship leader, is sixth. Tolsma, who started 10th, sits in seventh. Crawford has come from 18th to 8th. Mark Simo from 24th to 9th. And Rob Rizzo has been as high as 5th, as far back as I believe it was 30th or 31st, and now back inside the top 10. So it's been a great run for the New Yorker. McDonald, Wallace, Raines, Barfield, Schrader, the remainder of your top 15 under the fourth caution flag of the day here at Watkins Glen, and the one that will set up a quick dash to the finish.
And unfortunately, Bob Keselowski had to stop and get a splash of fuel. He was running in the 23rd spot, so he will lose four spots unless he can get him back on the restart. He will go back to the 26th spot.
And the way that truck's been behaving this weekend, Benny, I'll bet he worked harder for those four spots than Hornaday did to lead this thing for 50-something laps. Let's get an update on the leader as we go back down trackside.
Well, remember when we were were back at Phoenix, and Mike Bliss, you know, he had a problem and couldn't make it to the finish line because we had the similar situation. He ran out of fuel. Remember Ron Hornaday? They stopped earlier this second session rather than the first time. Looked like it was a good move. Well, it may backfire now because they are going to be pushing the envelope as far as their fuel capacity. So we'll have to keep an eye on the 16 truck.
How about Joe Rutland, who did not put any fuel in? Remember, these laps have got to be...
Yeah.
Wow.
Going to be very, very interesting to see who has the fuel to go finish here.
Yeah, Marty, that's a good point you bring up.
Well, the other thing to remember here, remember Roush has been getting better fuel mileage than anybody else in pit lane, so he's the least of the guys I would be worried about right now. It would be Bliss and also Hornaday that I'd be looking at, and throw in Barsett into that mix.
Uh-huh. Interesting stuff here, as it's taken him a while to get Wayne Anderson's car, or to Wayne Anderson's truck, out of the way down there, just at the head on the front straightaway. So we're going to seize the opportunity to get in our last commercial break and come back for the finish. We're back through hoops to make sure this didn't turn out to be a fuel mileage derby, and guess what? It may well be decided by a few drops of gas.
Scott Walters just made a pit stop to put fuel in his truck. The Red Man truck had to stop. There we see him leaving. And I'm telling you, if Hornaday was close on gasoline, he's going to have to run about three or four extra laps.
The race distance is now complete. The last time by, still under caution, was the end of 62, the planned distance for the event. The NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series rules require not only that the race not finish under yellow, but when it restarts after that final yellow, it's green, white, checker. They take the green flag, they run a lap, then they take the white flag, they run another lap to the checker. Not a big deal on the half mile of I-70 Speedway, perhaps, but could be a very big deal here.
On a 2-mile racetrack, when you're low on fuel, it is a big deal.
Hornaday will be watching the pressure gauge intently as we prepare for this restart. The 16 truck pitted on lap 35, and, well, you can do the arithmetic. You mentioned the championship battle, Wallace and Gordon. Gordon now the point leader. That's your front row at Dover. Ford's having another good qualifying effort. Dover coming up tomorrow, the MDNA 400, and then the following weekend, of course, we're off to Richmond for the night race. We're going to be all over that one. We're going to have the Busch Series for you, the Hardys 250 on Friday, the Bud Bowl qualifying. Then, of course, NASCAR Today, your pre-race show on Saturday, followed by the race itself, the Pontiac Excitement 400 at 7 o'clock Eastern Time, a Saturday night short track shootout in Richmond. We'll have it right here on ESPN.
Dave and I will be bringing you NASCAR Today tomorrow on ESPN2.
That we will. We're going to
11:30
catch the bird right after this baby is over and head back to Charlotte as we get prepared for tomorrow's big show. Right now, the big question is all about fuel. They should get the signal at the inner loop. Actually, should have gotten the signal as we prepare for the restart here, or we'll get the signal. They either have or have not received the signal, Benny, is what I'm trying to say.
And they have. They have received it because we see the light is on atop the pace truck.
That's what we were trying to get pointed out as we get ready for the restart. Chevrolet has won 5 times on the road courses, Ford 3. Dodge has yet to win one and will not today. But the question is whether it will be Chevy or Ford, because the Chevy out front may be short on fuel. And I haven't heard much speculation about whether Borisette's got the stuff to make the distance. We would think that Rutman would be the best candidate to be able to go the full distance. He's sitting in third. Onboard camera, as we see some of the guys in the back of the field. Butch Miller in 20th spot, tail end of the top 20. Haven't heard much from Stacy Compton after he blew an engine in qualifying yesterday.
Looks like Bars is kind of laying back to get him a run. 4 or 5 car lengths. He's going to try to time this.
He's going, Bars. He might get him a black flag.
Those carefully laid plans.
Well, if that was the strategy, you heard the speculation from the pit about the possibility of a black flag. That's the only possibility, I think. Ruffin had a notion, looked on the outside, upset, could not get anything done there. A 2-lap shootout to decide the points of...
Meanwhile, Mark Simo got by
Rick Crawford to take over the eighth spot going down to turn one. There's the battle for second spot.
Stop running.
Morris is out of gas. I believe he's out of gas.
And there goes Ruttman right on by, and that would account for the slow restart for Boris Said. It looked like strategy, but apparently he was pedaling as fast as
he was. Oh, and Flint almost spun out. He slid the tire.
Fair.
Went in the corner, but Sauter closed up, and his that is Bliss off the racetrack.
Bliss could not get it gathered back up and goes darting across the inner loop, losing positions both on entrance and exit. Mike Bliss in danger of dropping outside the top 10 now as Hornaday makes it back around with one to go. Next time across start finish, and his challenge now will be...
He's getting a black. Hornaday is getting a black flag, I do believe. Yes, he is. Hornaday is getting a black flag for jumping the restart.
Going up that hill, but slow on gas. Wiggle it around, do your best.
And they gave the white flag to Joe Ruttman.
Man. That will create a stir, I guarantee you. Ron Hornaday, the race leader, jumped the start. That's been one of the more controversial rules NASCAR has dealt with of late. The incident, of course, down at Daytona and the bunt shootout with Rusty Wallace and Jeff Gordon, the one a year ago when Wallace on the restart at Martinsville. Now this.
And Jay Sauter back there is trying to stay in front of the back. Boris Said now has his truck running well enough to be in fourth.
Make it wide.
Trying to hang on to positions here. Sauter has gotten in front of him in the three into fourth spot. Third
I guess
spot.
Third spot, because let's forget, not forget that Ron Hornaday has been black flagged.
Man. So Hornaday, I guess, will simply come on around and be ignored as he crosses start-finish, we assume, and the checker will fall on Ruttman.
Meanwhile, a pass for position backer Mark Simo takes another spot away from Randy Tolsma.
That team's going to have a great day here. Simo's got a shot at the top five as Bliss takes one more run at Tolsma. There goes the leader by, and there's the checker falling on the 99 of Ruttman. Hornaday did not get the checkered flag, and his position will be determined, I guess, by NASCAR's decision. Ruttman is the winner of the Parts America 150 in a remarkable conclusion to this NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series Championship event. Joe Ruttman declared the winner, and Jack Sprague, taking fourth spot, will hang on to the point lead by virtue of that finish. And the black flag for the two-time champion. We'll get a quick opportunity to talk to the race winner when we come back to Watkins Glen. The Parts America 150 is over, and Joe Ruttman has won it.
On Hornaday has pulled in. Now, they gave you the black flag, not the checker flag, but you came in here.
Boris Said was laying back, and I got the same spot when I got on the gas the time before that. Driver starts the race. The leader starts racing. Exactly, we asked that twice. The initial start was at the bridge. I started what I did. If Boris wanted to do that, Boris even admits that he misses a shift, so I don't know what else to say.
All right, guys, we got to go. The winner, we'll get you an interview for RPM tonight. That's going to do it from here. David.
We thank you for being part of this wild finish of the Parts America 150. So long, everyone.